Hi, here we are back in the simulation center again. And today, Amanda is going to talk to us a little bit about the blood vessels and blood flow through the blood vessels. We'll be talking about systolic and diastolic blood pressure, and we're going to learn proper assessment techniques so that if you're checking your blood pressure at home, you'll be able to know that you're getting an accurate reading. Amanda, take it away.
Hi, welcome back to the Sim Lab. So to get started taking a blood pressure, you need to make sure you have the appropriate equipment. You need an inflatable cuff attached to a sphygmomanometer or sphygmomanometer. And you can see here that there's it has a gauge, which is measured in millimeters of mercury, or mmHg. And that's a pressure measurement. Cuffs come in different sizes. Here's an adult cuff. And here we have a pediatric cuff. Now, it's very important to make sure you have the right size cuff when you're taking the blood pressure. There's a marker, an indicator, on the blood pressure cuff that shows you where to line up the cuff with the patient's artery in their arm. Here it is on the smaller cuff.
When I go volunteer, sometimes we only have one size cuff, and there are different sizes of people who I take blood pressures of. Would you recommend that I still take their blood pressure?
That's a really good question, Stacy. In an ideal situation, you would have the perfect size cuff for every patient, but we often don't. Mm-hmm. What I would recommend is that you take the blood pressure and then make a notation that the cuff was too big or too small. And that'll give anyone using those measurements an idea that this was not especially accurate. Okay, good question. Now, let me show you how to put on a cuff. So, thank you, Vanessa.
You're welcome.
Here's the artery marker. I'm going to line it up with Vanessa's brachial artery. The bottom of the cuff is right in the crook of her elbow. Now, the cuff should be not too tight and not too loose. This is often kind of an awkward process, so you may find that your provider takes a couple of minutes to fiddle with it.
Amanda,
yes.
I see that you're supporting Vanessa's arm while you're putting on the cuff.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes when I have my blood pressure checked, my practitioner has my arm down at my side. Does that make a difference?
Well, that's a very good question, Dr. Skanga. Ideally, you want to take the blood pressure in the left arm and have the left arm supported so that the cuff is as close as possible to the same level as the heart. That will give you the most accurate reading. Now, sometimes we're pressed for time. We know a patient's history and that they don't have a blood pressure problem. And we might not have the setup, for example, where you volunteer, you might not be able to do that. So we do the best that we can to be accurate. Very good question. So what I'm going to do here is inflate the pump. And what'll happen is it will inflate this cuff and occlude the arteries in the upper part of Vanessa's arm. What that will do is cause the arteries to collapse and prevent blood flow. Now, I will take my stethoscope and listen just under the edge of the cuff here, in the center of her arm, to her brachial artery. Okay. And I can hear the blood rushing through her artery here. Well, let me talk about what we're going to do before I occlude your arteries here. So what I'm going to do is pump up the cuff, occlude the arteries up here, and I'm going to inflate the cuff until the gauge reads a little higher than I would guess your blood pressure would be. Okay, so I probably would inflate your cuff to about 160. Then I'm going to listen with my stethoscope right here over the brachial artery. Now, Stacy, am I going to be able to hear anything when the cuff is fully inflated?
No.
And why is that?
Because you've collapsed the artery so that blood cannot go through anymore.
Great, great, okay. So then, once I've reached that point, I can't hear anything, the arteries are fully occluded, I'm going to release the gauge here and deflate the cuff. I'm going to be listening and watching the gauge. Now, when I first hear the blood rush back into her brachial artery, I'm going to make a note of the reading here. Now, when providers take your blood pressure, the sounds that we hear are called Karat cough sounds. The first Karat cough sound is the first sound that we hear, the blood rushing back into your artery. Now, after I hear that first Karat cough sound, I'm going to continue listening and watching the gauge. And then when I no longer hear the turbulent sound, I'm going to make a note of the reading on the gauge. Okay?
Amanda, now, yes. Could I interject?
Please do.
I know that sometimes when people are first starting to learn to take blood pressures, they watch the gauge and they watch the needle moving. And when they stop seeing bounces in the needle, they think they've achieved diastolic pressure, which is not actually correct. Like, you've got to make sure that what you're really listening for is the stopping of sound, right?
That's very important.
Not the jumping
around. Not the jumping of the needle. Some people do use that as a rough indicator of blood pressure, but the most accurate way is to listen. And it takes some practice, which is why we'll be practicing here in the lab. Now, let me take your blood pressure, and then there'll be more questions, ladies. Okay, 110 over 62. Now, what is that top number?
It's called the systolic pressure.
And the bottom number?
The diastolic pressure.
Okay. Do they
remember what those mean, what the systolic means versus what the diastolic means about what's going on with somebody's body, their heart, and their blood vessels?
You can correct me if I'm wrong, but from what I remember, the systolic blood pressure is the pressure and the amount of force it takes for the heart to contract at the end of the ventricular systole, and for that to pump the blood through and up through the arteries and into our blood flow, depending on the pressure in the vessels.
Cool.
Very good.
So how much force has to be generated? How much work does the heart, the left ventricle specifically, have to do to eject blood? Yes. Excellent. And diastolic?
I think the diastolic is how much pressure is around the smaller arteries around the body. Is that right?
Can you tell us more about that?
What do you think of as diastole in terms of the heart? What happens during diastole?
Okay, so diastolic pressure is the lowest pressure that we experience during one cardiac cycle, right? So the heart's relaxed. And what's happening in the blood vessels to blood when the heart's relaxed?
The blood is flowing.
Exactly, it's still flowing. And the more easily blood can flow out into the periphery during diastole, the lower the diastolic pressure will be, right? And so if somebody has hypertension, we expect there will be more resistance in the arterioles, and that resistance is going to make it harder for blood to flow off into the periphery. And so what will we see in terms of their diastolic blood pressure?
It'll be higher.
It'll be higher, exactly. So systolic pressure tells us something about how hard the heart is working, and diastolic pressure tells us something about what's happening out in the peripheral blood vessels in terms of how effectively they're letting blood circulate.
we're really tough on our students, but you can see how important it is to understand the anatomy and physiology behind what we do in the clinic. Now, before we get started and practicing a little bit more, I want to remind you that when you take someone's blood pressure in the clinic, you want to give them a few minutes to rest and relax. So in case they're very happy to see you or very nervous about seeing you or if they had to rush to their appointment, you want to give them a chance to get back to their normal blood pressure and relax. Okay, do you guys have any more questions?
Not at the moment.
All right, let's get you set up and practicing on each other.
Okay.